Okay, if I could ask those leaving the public gallery to do so as quickly and as quietly as possible as we proceed with the next item of business, which is a member's business debate on motion 12342 in the name of Colette Stevenson on shining a light on domestic abuse in LGBT plus History Month. I'd invite members, with the debate will be concluded without any questions being put, but I would encourage members wishing to participate to press the request to speak buttons, and I invite Colette Stevenson to open the debate around 7 minutes. Ms Stevenson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I'm grateful to members for supporting my motion. The catalyst for this debate was a recent stakeholder roundtable we had in Parliament led by Dr Stephen Maxwell from the University of Glasgow on domestic abuse in the LGBTQ plus community. Bringing together MSPs, Dr Maxwell and representatives from councils, police and third sector, this event allowed us to have an open conversation about the many challenges LGBTQ plus people experience, not only the harm of domestic abuse, but the barriers in accessing support. This was followed with a report which has 14 recommendations, and I will try to cover as much of these as I can in the time that I have. Domestic abuse is an abhorrent crime, and we all recognise the harm it causes to individuals and to our society. There have been some big developments in recent years in terms of tackling the damage of domestic abuse, including the Domestic Abuse Scotland Act 2018, which brought together within one offence the modern understanding of what domestic abuse looks like, including psychological domestic abuse such as coercive and controlling behaviour. The Scottish Government also developed the Equally Safe strategy to prevent and eradicate violence against women and girls. This sets out a vision of prevention, improving support services and strengthening the justice response for victims and perpetrators. These developments are very welcome. However, at the round table, we heard about the issues when it comes to gender framing of policies, and many people in the community don't fit into societal assumptions on masculinity or femininity, or into traditional binary gender norms. So there's a need to ensure that policy and practice works to ensure anyone experiencing domestic abuse can get the support that they need. The roundtable participants agreed that there needs to be a national LGBTQ plus domestic abuse action plan, and perhaps based on or aligned with Equally Safe, and I hope the government will consider this. Presiding Officer, underpinning the issues and the invisibility of domestic abuse faced by the community is data collection. There are challenges in understanding the extent of such crimes, and for example, the Crown Office publishes a breakdown of the sex of the accused in domestic abuse charges, but not the sex of the victim. And Police Scotland sometimes includes the sex of both the suspect and the victim in its statistics. We know that most cases of domestic abuse don't get reported, and I would encourage any victim to seek support from organisations who can help them. And there are many great services out there. Looking at Police Scotland data from 2022 to 23, where gender was recorded, around 3% of recorded domestic abuse incidents involved same-sex victims and suspects. This equates to around 1,500 incidents. There is no breakdown of these figures for transgender people. However, research suggests that between 30 to 45% of LGBTQ plus people will experience intimate partner violence, and this is in line with levels experienced by women in heterosexual relationships. I hope the government can work alongside its partners in the justice sector to consider what approaches can be taken to better understand the scale of LGBTQ plus domestic abuse, and perhaps initially to get official estimates of the prevalence of this. One of the challenges for LGBTQ plus people who are experiencing domestic abuse is a nervousness about engaging with statutory services. And it was interesting to hear police officers at the roundtable acknowledging the concerns that many LGBTQ plus people have, while being clear on a commitment to ensuring Scotland's police force resembles and acts for the diverse communities that make up modern Scotland. However, the changes that have to be made go well beyond the police. And a key part of policies like Equally Safe is to prevent domestic abuse from occurring in the first place. So there is a need to ensure that public sector bodies and indeed wider society is ready and able to prevent domestic abuse within the community. This could include developing an LGBTQ plus curriculum within existing sexual violence and domestic abuse courses, including those provided by statutory services. There's also a specific need for risk assessments to be more inclusive of LGBTQ plus experiences. For example, multi-agency risk assessment conferees, or MARACs, are used across Scotland to help identify high-risk cases. But concerns were raised at the roundtable that processes like this are structured around heterosexual norms. In fact, stakeholders mentioned that the prevalence of LGBTQ plus people being referred to support agencies through a MARAC was well below the expected number, which likely indicates an issue with the current safeguarding policies. So overall, there appears to be a significant underestimate of the prevalence of domestic abuse within the community. And in turn, this has perhaps meant that local services can't recognise and address the issue. This is not a criticism of services, but an example of why there has to be a shift in the approach to tackling domestic abuse. There is a lot to say on this topic, Presiding Officer, but I want to conclude by thanking Dr. Maxwell and his colleagues for their work to highlight this issue, as well as to the people who have taken part in research studies on LGBTQ plus domestic abuse. And I also want to thank everyone who took part in the roundtable earlier this year. I hope today's debate will shine a light on domestic abuse, encourage people to seek the support they deserve, and help begin the change we need to see for people in the community who experience domestic abuse, something which has for too long been hidden. I hope to meet with ministers soon to discuss the recommendations, and that the Scottish Government can help advance these, particularly around identifying gaps in service provision, ensuring agencies are equipped to deal with the specific challenges for the community, and helping ensure there's adequate data collection. We are all agreed in here that domestic abuse has no place in modern Scotland, and we must do everything we can to support anyone who experiences it.
Thank you, Ms Stevenson. We move to the open debate. I call first Emma Harper to be followed by Paul O'Kane, around 4 minutes. Ms Harper.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I welcome the opportunity to speak in this debate and congratulate my friend and colleague Colette Stevenson on securing it. Colette has outlined this issue really well, and I'm pleased to follow on from her at the beginning of LGBT plus History Month. I too want to start by condemning domestic abuse in all its forms, whether that be sexual assault, coercive control, psychological abuse, or any other form of controlling behaviour. Presiding Officer, the University of Glasgow has carried out a great deal of work on LGBT domestic abuse, and the findings of the report do make for some concerning reading. The research shows that LGBT plus people face the fear of being stigmatised and disbelieved by the police. Support services being designed for heterosexual people is also an issue, and a systemic lack of LGBT plus domestic abuse knowledge and inclusion across most services in Scotland. For the few inclusive services, the report recorded prolonged waiting lists and an inadequate safe accommodation for LGBT plus people, a problem which the report's author, Dr. Stephen Maxwell, has warned will only be worsened by impending local authority cuts. Dr. Maxwell said, and I quote, "Domestic abuse experiences of LGBTQ plus victims and survivors are overlooked and unheard." One in three LGBTQ plus adults will experience domestic abuse in their lifetime, the same level as heterosexual women. And we know that this abuse does indeed have a profound impact on a person's life. So it's absolutely crucial that the Scottish Government does all it can to get the services right for our LGBT plus community. We must deliver parity of esteem for domestic abuse services for all victims of domestic abuse of any and all sexual orientations. Presiding Officer, there is a clear way forward to improve the current situation. According to Dr Maxwell, there are a number of steps that could reduce the high-risk situations that LGBT plus victims experience. The starting point is for the Scottish Government to review the national policy Equally Safe, which Colette Stevenson has mentioned. The national policy Equally Safe is where LGBT plus and domestic abuse experiences could be included, and that's another quote from the University of Glasgow. They say that the LGBT people's experiences are invisible in Equally Safe strategy. The report is calling for a tailored national action plan to provide visible, competent measures to meet people's needs. This includes stronger prevention, service inclusion messages, more inclusive safe spaces and practitioner workforce education, including through, for example, TURAS e-learning modules for health and social care staff. Previously, as a clinical nurse educator, I developed and delivered e-learning courses, and it seems pretty achievable to me that this is something that we could pursue. So I would ask the Minister if this could be considered. Presiding Officer, as Colette Stevenson's motion shows, the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service statistical publications show that 30,139 charges were reported to the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service with domestic abuse identifier in 2022-2023. In these cases, the accused was male in 86% of reports. But that means that 4,219 women were the perpetrators of domestic abuse. We do need to ensure that policies such as Equally Safe are working to support anyone who has experienced domestic abuse, and it is not all just a women-only problem. One excellent example of work being undertaken to support the LGBT plus people who had experienced domestic abuse is the charity Gallup. Gallup specialise in supporting victims and survivors of domestic abuse, sexual violence, hate crime, honour-based abuse, forced marriage, conversion therapies and other types of interpersonal abuse. Gallup is run by the LGBT plus people for LGBT plus people, and this needs the community are basically at the heart of everything that Gallup does. It is a fantastic organisation, and I would like to hear from the Minister whether the Scottish Government could engage with this organisation. I am just closing. Enabling our LGBT plus community to be supported in cases of domestic abuse and violence is crucial, and I welcome this debate. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Ms Harper. And I call Paul O'Kane to be followed by Marie McNair. Around 4 minutes, Mr O'Kane.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer, and can I thank Colette Stevenson for securing this debate today and taking time in this place to highlight the problems of domestic abuse, intimate partner violence and indeed the challenges faced by members of the LGBT plus community is vitally important. And these issues demand constant attention and focus to ensure that we continue to progress in the right direction, making clear that there is no place for domestic abuse in Scotland and furthering indeed the rights and equality of LGBT plus people. The motion before us references the view that structural inequalities could be prohibiting LGBT plus victims of domestic abuse from coming forward or receiving the support that they need. And I want to start by addressing those structural inequalities, because there is no doubt in my mind that of late the rhetoric in relation to LGBT plus people has become more toxic. We, of course, have come a long way since the days of Section 28 and the homophobia of years gone by. But there can be no mistaking that, and we should not kid ourselves, that homophobia and transphobia are still present in our politics, our media and our society. And indeed, some of the headlines in the press over the past few weeks and some of the reactions and the commentary on them have crossed the line, I think, from nuanced, responsible and sensitive questioning of policy into full-throated, stereotypical attacks, which are met with hurt and very often fear by LGBT plus people across Scotland. And I think it is those feelings of hurt and fear that very often convince people that they won't be heard or taken seriously, that indeed they are still looked on as other. So I think when we talk about domestic abuse and intimate partner violence, both within and out with the LGBT plus community, but we still can't talk in a sensible way about inclusive education and support that treats LGBT plus identities as normal and valid, is it any wonder that we are concerned about underreporting of the problems that people face? And I think we've heard some of this already, but I think it is why education is so important. Education around domestic abuse and indeed what it means to be LGBT plus in Scotland, I think that remains completely vital. And it's why I, and I know many others across the chamber, continue to support organisations like the TIE campaign so we can increase understanding and support to young people. Because there are still too many young LGBT plus people in Scotland who are scared to talk about themselves, their identity and their experiences because they don't see themselves reflected in their education and in society. And beyond tackling that general stigma that is faced by LGBT plus people and helping them empower them to speak out, we know that all of this needs to go hand in hand with tackling stigma and fear there is generally about domestic abuse and intimate partner violence. And I do recognise we've made significant progress in the way that we talk about domestic abuse in the context of violence against women and girls. There is, of course, much, much more to do. And I stand with the work that the government is doing and the excellent work of organisations such as White Ribbon Scotland, particularly in terms of ensuring that men take responsibility for changing our attitudes and behaviours. Deputy Presiding Officer, we are debating this motion at the beginning of the government of a new First Minister and Deputy First Minister. And indeed, I would like to take this opportunity to thank Emma Ruddock, who I see is in the chamber, for all of her work in her time as Minister for Equalities, Migration and Refugees, particularly in these areas, which I know she took a keen interest in. And I wish her well on the backbenches, where I know she will continue to advocate on all of these issues. And can I say to the government, we must now not roll back on the hard-fought rights of LGBT plus people, but rather this government must show commitment and progress whilst building a consensus across our country, just as we have done at every milestone for LGBT plus people in the past. And as I have said in this chamber before, we aren't going back into the closet, and we aren't going to hide, and we aren't going to be ashamed of who we are. So I do support the calls in the motion for a national LGBT plus domestic abuse strategy to raise awareness and improve services so they are accessible to everyone in that community. And I call on the government in responding to reflect on that. I think we must start the journey on tackling this important issue today. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. O'Kane. I now call Marie McNair to be followed by Jamie Green. Around 4 minutes, Ms. McNair.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I thank my colleague Colette Stevenson for bringing this important debate to the Chamber to help us highlight the issue of domestic abuse in LGBTQ plus relationships. Domestic abuse knows no boundaries and it follows no rules. It can happen to anyone, regardless of sexual orientation or gender identity. It can take many forms, be that emotional, psychological, physical or sexual abuse. In 2022-23, it was reported that 30,139 charges were reported to the Crown Office and the Procurator Fiscal Service with a domestic abuse identifier, and the accused was male in 86% of these cases. However, it is noted by Police Scotland that 1,691 domestic abuse incidents were recorded with same-sex victims and suspected perpetrators in 21-22. These figures are concerning, but highlight the possibility that LGBTQ+ domestic abuse may go widely unreported. Societal discrimination, stigma or inequalities may be prohibiting LGBTQ plus victims of domestic abuse from coming forward to receive the support they so greatly deserve. This is backed up by research which notes that underreporting is common due to not feeling safe or able to identify their experiences of abuse within typical assumptions of heterosexual dominance. Research also suggests that rates of underreporting within LGBTQ plus population are between 60 to 80%, which is consistent with the national underreporting rate of 79%, according to the Office of National Statistics in 2018. We cannot allow fear and stigma to prevent survivors from seeking help and support. So it's important that we do more to include LGBTQ plus survivors within our discussions and actions on domestic abuse.
Some studies suggest around 40% of individuals in LGBTQ+ relationships may experience domestic abuse. And it's also been noted that higher rates of domestic abuse are found amongst those identifying as transgender. And according to the Scottish Trans Alliance, 80% of transgender victims in their study had experienced domestic abuse. And this has been backed up by recent literature finding that transgender individuals are 2 times more likely to experience physical abuse and nearly 3 times more likely to experience sexual abuse than cisgender individuals. And experiencing this alongside transphobia can lead to severe and concerning mental health issues. So in tackling domestic abuse, we must also address the root causes of misogyny, homophobia and toxic masculinity. We must challenge harmful stereotypes and attitudes that result in discrimination towards LGBTQ people. We must also educate each other on the warning signs of domestic abuse to help break the cycle of violence. Relationships must be built upon mutual respect and compassion. No one should ever be fearful of violence or coercive control within the relationship. And when you reflect on the achievements and struggles of the LGBT community throughout history, I'd like to remember all those victims of domestic abuse. To those who have felt their life shattered around them, to those who have felt invisible, you're not alone. In fact, I experienced it too, and I'm here to show that we won't be silenced. And I do so in recognition that it's important to speak out and empower others to do so, to recognise the signs of when you're being gaslighted, bullied and manipulated, and that you're strong, resilient and have the strength and support to stand up to bullies and speak out. To assert that this type of behaviour is wrong and not welcome in any part of this society. I'm here on your side because I've been there, and can I thank my colleague Colette Stevenson again for bringing this really important debate to the Chamber. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms McNair. I now call Jamie Green to be followed by Emma Ruddock, around 4 minutes. Mr Green.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I first of all pay tribute to Colette Stevenson and her relentless work on this issue and for bringing stakeholders to this Parliament earlier this year. I'd like to congratulate her on the longest motion I've ever read in the Parliament. It read more like a report, which is excellent, and testament to her office as well. But contained in that report is a lot to get through, and I'm going to cover 3 very specific areas of the motion that I think we should debate. I also would like to put on record my thanks and tribute to those who did a lot of the groundwork and research into the subject, particularly Dr. Stephen Maxwell, the University of Glasgow, who has been relentless in keeping MSPs up to date on his work, and of course for informing the stakeholder roundtable that we had in February, which I attended and was grateful for. But I also would like to thank those in the third sector. It was mentioned already, Emma Harper mentioned Gallup, who organise a domestic abuse helpline, the National Domestic Abuse Helpline, which specifically helps LGBT people. But also, I think one of the most profound things I heard at that roundtable was the lived experience of many of the young people who attended and some of the very moving and very difficult stories that they shared with us. It's never easy when we attend these groups to listen to what's actually happening out there in the real world when we're so often caught up in statistics and policy documents. But why is all this important? Because, well, I think it goes without saying that domestic abuse is abhorrent and unacceptable to all of us. I think that's become something that all parties have signed up to over the last couple of years. The legislation that we've passed through DASA, another piece of legislation, the debate we had last week was another good example of cross-party working on how we as a Parliament use the powers available to us to tackle this abhorrent practice. But particularly the experience of LGBT plus people is quite a unique one, because for all the reasons we've just heard, they often feel that inability to report, they feel the stigma that comes with it, not just the stigma of being in an LGBT relationship, which is often difficult depending on the community they live in, but then to have to admit that they are suffering some form of abuse or coercive behaviour and physical and mental violence. Of course, the equally safe strategy is a good framework, because what it did is it unpicked how we can take a government policy and design it around particular groups of people and meet the needs of those. And one of the things that came out from the report from Dr. Maxwell was that was actually a welcome analysis of how different routes and pathways by which services can be delivered to people is so important, but equally the awareness of access to those services is important too. The point I wanted to make is an important one, and that's that we need LGBT plus specific services. And the reason for that is because most people within the community who have been surveyed felt invisible, and that's the language they used, invisible in these services. There was a huge reluctance of reporting to the police. I think the Police Scotland attendees at that roundtable acknowledged that. Now, there has been a lot of work done on training for frontline officers on how they deal with DASA and how they deal with situations that they respond to. But what happens when they turn up and they're faced with a domestic situation which is an LGBT household? Are they fully confident that they know how to deal with that and gather the appropriate evidence that may be used by the Crown down the line? And I'm not convinced, and nor was the roundtable convinced by that. And the final point I wanted to make was that barrier to services and awareness. Now, a lot's been said over the last few weeks about organisations like LGBT Youth Scotland and the Thai Campaign and other organisations who help and educate young people. Education is absolutely key. The earlier we educate people about appropriate relationships and what constitutes abuse, the better, in my view, and there's nothing controversial to say about that. And finally, I'd like to put on record my own personal thanks to Emma Roddick for the work that she's done in government. I know many people have been gloating over her exit. I think that's disgraceful. I think everyone who gets into public office deserves the respect and thanks for doing so. And I'd like to thank Colette Stevenson for bringing this really important matter to the Chamber, and I hope it's something we can revisit in future. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Green. I now call Emma Roddick to be followed by Maggie Chapman in around 4 minutes. Ms. Roddick.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I want to first thank Colette Stevenson for bringing this important debate forward. I know that she's taken a special interest in this issue, and her allyship is so incredibly valuable, and I'm sure it's appreciated by many of her constituents as well as the wider community. And I felt throughout this debate the weight and the value of the contributions from Marie McNair, from Paul O'Kane, Jamie Green, Emma Harper, and particularly right now when LGBTQ plus rights are under sustained and constant attack. Attack which Paul O'Kane described very articulately, and I'm grateful to him and to Jamie Green for their kind comments. And I will say, while you expect comments of support in times like this from your closest allies, I've been so appreciative of the comments from many colleagues on particularly the Labour and Green benches, but also the Conservatives as well. I've always tried to build relationships cross-party, and I have massive respect for many MSPs across this chamber, and it's been lovely to feel some reciprocation of that today. And it's perhaps most important right now when we are considering equalities issues, be it for the LGBTQ plus community, disabled people, refugees and people seeking asylum, people who experience racism, many other groups that I've had the privilege to work with in government and who are under constant public attack. Those of us who recognise the unfair and indefensible harms being caused to regular people who just want to live their lives and be who they are must speak up, and as much as we can, and across party lines. Progress is not linear and it's not guaranteed. We can and we must not lose ground. The toxicity of the public debate on LGBTQ plus issues makes it harder for people to report or even acknowledge many of the harms that are being done to and experienced by queer people in Scotland. That is absolutely and undoubtedly extending to domestic abuse in LGBTQ plus relationships. I've heard from people that they struggle to come forward because they think unless it is male violence directed at a woman, it won't be taken seriously or even seen as real domestic abuse. Others report feeling shame about their sexuality, which then contributes to that tendency to hide when things go wrong in case that they are outed or criticised or subject to queerphobic abuse and victim blaming. And in both cases, it's clear that there is a lack of awareness about the risk of domestic abuse within LGBTQ plus relationships, as well as persistent assumptions about who carries it out and who is subject to these crimes. And that is contributing again to that lack of reporting and an inability to seek support. But we know, thanks to Dr. Stephen Maxwell's work at the University of Glasgow and his recent report, that one in three LGBTQ+ adults suffer domestic abuse in their lifetimes, the same rate as heterosexual women. I had the pleasure of meeting Dr. Maxwell during my time as Equalities Minister at an event discussing his research, and I'm so glad to see it being given the attention that it deserves in the Parliament. I know that there's a massive amount of work going on in the third sector to address these issues from the likes of the Equality Network, LGBT Youth, Terence Higgins Trust and Rape Prices Scotland, who are putting in so much hard work. And other LGBTQ people like me will know how important raising awareness of these issues is and how far we've still to go. They will, like me, be used to people outright denying the daily experiences of LGBTQ+ people and living in happy ignorance of the homophobia and transphobia that still exist in Scotland today. Now, I know the Minister cares very deeply about the work that she's been tasked with carrying out with Equally Safe Strategies and ending hate crime in Scotland, and I'm so glad to see her asked to remain in government to carry this on. I hope that she will reflect on the information provided by Dr. Stephen Maxwell, by those that Colette Stevenson brought to Parliament and shared in this debate, and consider what more the Scottish Government can do to ensure that all victims of domestic abuse are included in policies and strategies aimed at ending it. Nobody should be subject to domestic abuse, and we cannot end it or support victims if we do not know and accept the risk to LGBTQ+ people. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Ruddock. And I now call Maggie Chapman, around 4 minutes, Ms Chapman.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I want to begin by thanking Colette Stevenson for securing this debate and for highlighting that people experience domestic abuse and intimate partner violence within a wide range of situations, identities and relationships. Her comprehensive motion raises many important issues, of which I would like to focus on just one: the experience of trans and non-binary survivors of domestic abuse. And I thank Scottish Transgender Alliance, LGBT Youth Scotland, the Equality Network, Stonewall and others for their painstaking and sensitive work in this area. Trans people experience disproportionately high levels of domestic abuse. That abuse includes physical and sexual violence, emotional and financial abuse, controlling and coercive behaviour. Perpetrators deny their trans partners essential access to medication and treatment. They prevent them from expressing their identity. They undermine their decisions and manipulate their vulnerability, intentionally leaving them ashamed of who they are and guilty about living with integrity. Trans partners are often isolated from family and friends, sometimes outed before they are ready. Those who are parents may face denial of contact with their children and encouragement of those children to reject or abuse them. We know that potential predators seek out people who are vulnerable because of their previous experiences of abuse, trauma, or rejection. Trans and non-binary children and young people are disproportionately likely to be estranged from their families and to have undergone abuse, including conversion practices. The cumulative and combined mental health impacts of family and intimate partner abuse can be devastating, especially for young people and for those early in their transition process. And all of these forms and consequences of abuse are made so very much worse by toxic media and political narratives. The myths and tropes of transphobia serve to normalise abuse, to embed feelings of worthlessness and isolation, and to block pathways to support and recovery. It's hard to seek help when you are told that you don't deserve it, that this is the only relationship you'll ever have, that safety and respect don't apply to you. It's hard to find help when your family and friends turn away, when you're still learning the norms that cis people have been taught every day of their lives. It's hard to contact support services when political rhetoric says that a refuge is no safe place for you. Those services, and I refer members to my own register of interests, have been supporting trans people safely for many years. But that good practice is too often invisible or vilified. So what can we do? How can we, in this place, with the privilege we have, show our solidarity and care for our trans and non-binary neighbours enduring such abuse? We can be courageous, speaking out against the rhetoric of hate and fear, recognising the scale and depth of the problem and the ways in which political discourse and political choices have failed those we ought to protect. We can be sensitive, working with and supporting civil society organisations that have built expertise, learning from them and, most of all, from transgender and non-binary people themselves. We can be fair, properly funding services that address all forms of domestic abuse, including specialist support for minority and intersectional survivors. We can be progressive, including and acting robustly and radically to address misogyny, including transmisogyny, bringing in a comprehensive ban on conversion practices and ensuring that young and older people can access the healthcare, the respect, the dignified processes that they still need, that they still deserve. To conclude, Presiding Officer, I'd like to speak once more to the trans community, to our neighbours, our friends, our family. Much has changed, and for the worse, but our solidarity and our care remain. You are treasured, and you are not forgotten.
Thank you, Ms Chapman. And I now invite Siobhan Brown to respond to the debate. Minister, around 7 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd like to express my thanks to Colette Stevenson, MSP, for putting forward the motion for today's debate on domestic abuse in LGBTQI plus relationships. Presiding Officer, if I may, I'd also like to give my thanks to Emma Roddick for all the work that she has done and that I know she will champion from the backbenches to continue for the LGBTQI plus community. I'm proud to be closing this debate and have found all the contributions from members both powerful and thought-provoking. Intimate partner violence in same-sex relationships is devastating and heartbreaking and something which no one should ever have to endure. I'd like to pay tribute to those brave victims who have shown real courage in recounting their stories and shining a light on this important issue. I also acknowledge the specific barriers that LGBTQI plus people can face when accessing services and support. All domestic abuse and violence is abhorrent, irrespective of the sex, sexual orientation or gender identity of the victim or the perpetrator. That is why our groundbreaking domestic abuse legislation, which came into effect in 2019, applies to everyone and makes absolutely clear that coercive and controlling behaviour is domestic abuse and a crime. It is also why the Scottish Government funds services to support LGBTQI plus survivors of domestic and sexual abuse. It is vital that perpetrators are held to account and that victims have access to frontline services dealing with violence and domestic abuse. The Domestic Abuse Scotland Act 2018 created a specific offence of domestic abuse that covers not only physical abuse, but other forms of psychological abuse as well as coercive and controlling behaviour. We must treat domestic abuse survivors with compassion and availability of services which acknowledge the significant trauma that they've experienced. Research on the operation of our domestic abuse legislation found that it does better reflect victims' experiences. But we should never be complacent and instead recognise that there's always more that we can do and better. It's also vital that specialist services are available for survivors. Our Delivering Equally Safe Fund has provided support to the LGBTQI plus projects working to address domestic abuse. This includes SACRO's Fear-Free service, which provides one-to-one support for male and LGBT victims of domestic abuse. The Voice Unheard focus group, which aimed to raise awareness of the LGBTQI plus experiences of domestic abuse and gender-based violence with decision makers. And Scotland's Domestic Abuse and Forced Marriage Helpline, which provides support to all survivors. Additionally, we have allocated £16.2 million between 2017 and 18 to 23 to 24 to support the development of a sexual assault response coordination service, also known as SARCS, in each health board in Scotland. SARCS offers a healthcare assessment and forensic medical examination for people who have been recently raped or sexual assault. Subject to professional judgment, anyone aged 16 and over can access healthcare and request a forensic medical examination in the days following an assault without first having to report this to the police. And I acknowledge this is a very, very sensitive issue. We know from listening to survivors that access to self-referral is an important aspect of giving people back control. The Scottish Government remains committed to the continuous improvement of SARCs, with further funding planned for 24 to 25, bringing our total investment to almost £18 million over 7 years. While domestic abuse is most frequently perpetrated by males against the female partners, all domestic abuse and violence is unacceptable. And we published our refreshed Equally Safe strategy in December last year, which recognises LGBTQI plus people's experiences of domestic abuse and other forms of gender-based violence. Key LGBTQI plus stakeholders were consulted as part of the engagement process and helped shape the strategy and its references to the LGBTQI plus people's experiences. We know that from global evidence base shows that women and girls are disproportionately impacted by specific forms of violence against, such as domestic abuse. And Equally Safe is based on the framing of the United Nations and World Health Organization and has been acknowledged as a model of excellence. However, our approach does not negate the experiences of male victims of crime, such as domestic or sexual violence. Gender norms that promote ideals of masculinity based on men's power over women and children can also lead to men's experiences of abuse during childhood and sexual violence during adulthood. That is why the Scottish Government understands that LGBTQI plus people's experiences of domestic abuse as a form of gender-based violence. Key stakeholders also understand the issue in this way. We are committed to advancing equality for LGBTQI plus people and promoting and protecting and realising the rights of every LGBTQI plus person in Scotland. We will continue to fund third sector organisations to ensure that the voices of those with lived experiences can help to improve across these communities across Scotland. I would like to thank Dr. Stephen Maxwell, Professor Jamie Frankius, and colleagues for their research on LGBTQ plus intimate partner violence and to the victims who bravely shared their stories. As highlighted in the research and the subsequent parliamentary roundtable event in February, it is clear that there remain significant challenges for LGBTQI plus victims of domestic abuse. We do not want any victim of the LGBTQI plus domestic abuse to be made to feel invisible, and would encourage anyone who has experienced abuse to seek the support that they are entitled to. Some of this support I have outlined today. I'm fully committed to tackling domestic abuse, and I'm always willing to look at how we can improve our responses to all forms of domestic abuse, including the same-sex relationships, building on the provision that we already have. And my door is always open to any MSP that wants to continue to have these conversations on how we can improve things. And just for Emma Harper, I'm very happy to visit your organisation in the south of Scotland. By working collaboratively and innovatively, we can build a Scotland free from all forms of domestic abuse, where no one is left behind. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes the debate, and I suspend this meeting of Parliament until 2 o'clock.